You can't handle the truth. You can't handle the truth.
What do all men of power want? More power.
My name is Gianluca Zanna. I was an Italian by birth, and I became an American by choice. Our lives and freedoms are in danger.
This is not a
dream. If you're listening to this broadcasting, you are the resistance.
All systems go.
Welcome to Love, Guns, and Freedom.
We're not afraid.
Here we go, guys and girls. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna on K-Talks 1340 AM and also 104.1 FM. Another Sunday, another show. I'm very excited today, more than ever. Why? Because I really believe that living in Arizona, it gives you the opportunity as a regular person to be part of the process on how we can improve our freedoms or how we can retain our freedoms. And you know, it's very simple. Everything starts and ends really at the end in the political system. But it's also a lifestyle. You know, if you just mind your business, you do nothing, guess what? Bad things gonna happen. What I like about this state, things may not be perfect. We're always under attack, that's for sure. But you know, you can really reach out to our elected representatives in a way that normally I tell you, I've been around the world, forget about it. Italy, if you want to talk with your representative, you start to send probably maybe a gift for Christmas in form of coins. Here instead it's much more reachable. I had last Sunday Representative Leo Biasucci. We had a great conversation. And more important, you know, as I said, I'm not here as a party guy. I have no party. I gave up my Republican card about probably 5 years ago. So when I bring you people here, this is not about me trying to pursue any agenda. My only agenda is I would like to keep these freedoms that we have, that we are losing, of course, but we still have, and also the Constitution, our state Constitution, and also for me, the United States Constitution. I took an oath when I became a citizen. As simple as that. That's my agenda. I'm an American. I would like to stay like that. Now, I have with the honor today to have with me Beck, because I had him 5 years ago when I started this show. About 5 years ago, at the time was Representative Sonny Borrelli. Now is our state senator, Sonny Borrelli, for our district here. And now, I want to be clear, a little warning message here. I'm not a groupie of Sonny Borrelli. I like him as a person, but I had my political, you know, disagreements in the past. So I want to be sure that now the other side that will be going to call in this conversation, in this case, I'm going to call it, you know, the miner, the Kingman Daily Miner. They know, I don't want to think this is like some sort of a political piece, like, you know, I'm trying to bring, you know, my party. I have no party. I have no allegiance but the truth. That's it. And as I said, as much as I had my disagreement with Sonny Borrelli as a representative, I must tell you, I've been following his voting records the last year, and I'm very impressed. And I'm humbled to say, hey, great job. Great job. And I'm very proud because that's the point. You know, I may not agree with everything he does, but the most of the bills is going through. They're exactly what I was expecting for a representative who wants to somehow support the basic foundation of this country. A government that works for us, lower taxes, individual freedoms, and that's pretty much the what we want, at least here in this district. Now, let me shut up, and the reason why I want to bring in Senator Sonny Borrelli is because there is a very important article. There was even an article, it was an editorial, on the Kingman Daily Miner, this is a local newspaper that we have in Kingman, about a few days ago. And Senator Borrelli will talk more in details. What I was disturbed about this article, it wasn't about news. It wasn't about reporting the facts. It was about a very specific political opinion that, my humble opinion, it didn't really give the chance to our Senator Sonny Borrelli and also other two legislators to explain exactly how the things are. But more important, is the role of the newspaper to report the news or work in support of a specific political party? I don't care which party, okay? And by the way, people can say, hey, Luca, you have your opinions. Yes, I have, but I don't call myself a newsman. I'm just a regular guy that shares his opinion. Sometimes I may be right, sometimes I may be wrong, but that's all I do. I do opinions. Now, let me shut up and let me bring Senator Sonny Borrelli. Sonny Borrelli, are you there?
Yes, how are you?
Very good. That's been like 5 years since last time you came. You remember?
Yes, yes.
Time flies.
And you know what, Luca, you made a very strong point, you know, about agreeing and disagreeing. if everybody agreed with, here, just an example. If I agreed with you all.
I lost you. Senator, are you still there? That would happen. Senator, damn it.
A gray area in things, especially with these opinion pieces in the media. So, thank you for having me on your show. It's an honor.
No, it's my honor. And I must tell you, you're really a big guy. I'll tell you why. You know, as I said, we had our differences a couple years ago during the election time. And, you know, I wasn't anything personal, but I was pretty hard on you on the radio, okay? And you're cool. I tell you, I really like you because you are, as I said, we shake hands. And I tell you, I'm happy to say I was wrong. I was wrong when I said, you know, I mean, I underestimated you as a senator because I think you've done a lot of great bills that I'm proud of. Even I said that I think maybe we can still work, but you've done a lot of great things in the last year just. And that's all that matters for me. It's not about being right or about, oh, my guy or your guy. It's about what is good for us, for the citizens of Arizona. And I think you've done an incredible job, at least most of the things. Before we go into the Kingman Daily Miner aspect, because it's going to be the focus of the interview, at least this short interview, can you please tell two or three bills that you're proud that you were able to co-sponsor or at least sponsor or even just push through the legislature that I think they've done a great help for our tax dollar and also for our cause of freedom. I mean, I know that you've been working very hard on legalizing industrial hemp, but also so many other things. Please, go ahead.
Well, you know, my pet peeves are first and foremost are veterans and our public safety. Those are important. That's the primary role of government. And it's really difficult to just, you know, for a lot of folks, when you're talking policy about issues, they immediately think politics. There's a difference between politics and policy. If you have a good piece of policy and you're moving that, if it's a good policy, the politics will fall into play. But if you're pushing politics before policy, that's very problematic and you're going to have a lot of harder times getting things accomplished. You know, I don't like to, beat my own, drum or toot my own horn. You know, I try to work things as it's teamwork with our other representatives from our district and building coalitions and relationships with other legislators because that's how things get accomplished. Because if you don't do that, then politics gets right in the middle of a conversation, and you can't get policy done. Yes, industrial hemp was a great thing to push through. You know, it's going to be a good economic driver for Mojave County and the state. Public safety issues, protecting people's freedoms and you're trying to make sure that, the government stays out of your life as much as possible. But, there's so many outside forces working against us that, gets where it really gets difficult.
When I was talking, I was realizing just a few last week and I was talking with, Representative Biasucci. I didn't realize we are so close. Even I'm not partisan, as you know, I don't have any more the affiliation with any party. I'm independent. But still, I fear the Democrat Party because it's not about party. This is about an nihilistic agenda. I mean, this party now, it is not the Democratic Party of 50 years ago of Jack Kennedy. Now, this is like a completely plain communist movement. The goal is to destroy the fiber of this republic. And that's what I'm really concerned. We are only 2 seats away in our house in Arizona, the Arizona House, to lose this sort of control. And don't get me wrong, many Republicans, they're not even that good. But for sure now, if we lose that, that's going to be a scary reality for our state. So I'm really... go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Well, there you go, Luca. You know, it's hard to disagree with that statement because it's so close to the facts and reality. Unfortunately, in Arizona, the Democrats did not elect legislators. They elected primarily activists.
Yeah.
So I mean, they'll politic and politicize 2 raindrops on a window. I mean, it's crazy some of the things that they want to push and obstruct and get in the way of things. And you know, I sent out a couple of press releases, and you would think that our newspapers in this district would actually pick up on it. The only one that actually published it was a Havasu newspaper. But Kingman didn't touch it.
Let's talk about this press release because they're very important. I mean, I prefer if you can read them or at least explain them quickly, please.
What, the press releases?
Yeah, the content of the press release.
Well, Well, here, and this is, goes back to one of the original topics that why you called me about ballot initiatives. Because the Medical Marijuana Act passed, it's voter protected. So the only way to amend that to fix any kind of mistakes or unintended consequences, you have to have three-quarters vote of the House and the Senate. So there's 30 members in the Senate. That means I need 23 votes. There's 60 members in the House. I need 45 votes. Now, mm-hmm. the breakdown of our House and Senate right now politically is in the Senate, there's 17 Republicans, 13 Democrats. In the House, there's 31 Republicans, 29 Democrats. So you can tell it's, you need to have really bipartisan support on trying to get something fixed. Well, example, under the Medical Marijuana Act, there is nothing in there that gives the state any authorization whatsoever on the safety of the product that's being cultivated, packaged, and sold.
Mm-hmm.
For example, there are no restrictions whatsoever on the type of pesticides and chemicals that they can use during the
wow.
cultivation part.
Wow.
And even the Department of Health cannot even go into a dispensary and grab samples and put some kind of regulation on molds and bacteria of the marijuana that they're selling.
Wow.
Now, this is supposed, this was perpetrated onto the voter that this was supposed to be medicine.
Yeah.
But yet it's not treated like medicine.
Yeah.
So I introduced a bill last year and, of course, this year to just regulate and put some reasonable regulation on the pesticides.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
what I wanted to do is adopt the same pesticide regime of what the EPA and the USDA approved for other agricultural products, lettuce and tomatoes and so on and so forth.
I think that's great. And I mean,
those are deemed as the most harmless.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, because there's no regulation or oversight,
mm-hmm.
there's a product called Eagle 20. Eagle 20 is an antifungal pesticide that's banned in tobacco.
Wow.
Why is it banned in tobacco? Because it's a heavy carcinogen.
Wow.
And, you know, cancer causing. So, but there's no oversight or regulation to prohibit a marijuana grow facility from using that. But wait a minute, aren't there cancer patients that go get a medical marijuana card?
Exactly.
Now you're going to give them something that they are believing that is safe and it's medicine, but yet they're a cancer patient, and you could be giving something to somebody that's actually could make them sicker. It was a simple bill.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to treat this like an agricultural product, like any other plant. So the Department of Agriculture has the expertise for plant services and that kind of stuff for pesticides. They have the They're set up perfectly for, you know, the testing, samples, all that stuff. And it was just to regulate and do that. And so the Department of Agriculture would just basically regulate the pesticides. Well, you know, it went up for a vote, and I got 17 Republicans, 13 Democrats. Basically, I needed 23.
Wow.
So in essence, the Democrats voted no, because what they wanted to do, what they were doing was siding with the marijuana industry, because they don't want any regulation whatsoever.
Yeah.
They don't want any oversight from the health department or, for that matter, even the Department of Health. So, you know, there was another bill that I asked Senator Boyer to run for me, because I'm the majority whip. I didn't want to run a lot of bills. So
mm-hmm.
members, hey, if you like this bill, will you run it? I'll help you with it. And it was under the way the Medical Marijuana Act is, if the health department wants to go in, or even the Department of Revenue wants to go in and do their audit, they have to give them reasonable notice. Okay, well, that's fine for the audit, so that way they can get time to get things done. But for the health department just to go in there and do a safety inspection, they have to give them reasonable notice, which means, hey, I'm coming on these three dates. Would you pick one? So, well, the first two dates are not good for me, so come on Thursday at 3:00.
Mm-hmm.
So when the health department gets there, everything is closed down. There's no employees. There's almost no merchandise whatsoever on the place. So, in essence, hey, I'm going to come and check out your illegal gambling den on Thursday at 3:00. I'm giving you a heads up before I come in here. What's going to happen? They hide stuff.
Yeah.
So what Senator Boyer's bill would do is just change that from reasonable notice to during normal business hours. Now, the health department can go into any business, from a Burger King coffee shop, kiosk place, to an abortion clinic without notice, only during normal business hours, but yet they blocked this.
Wow.
I mean, so the hypocrisy and double standard is completely off the charts.
Yeah, that's interesting. I didn't know that. That's very interesting.
It went down the same boat. 17 and 13, all the Democrats voted no, which means they are protecting the marijuana industry because there's big bucks in it, and you know they have big donors and whatever. But this is the kind of step that, wait a minute, aren't you supposed to be here protecting, making sure that all businesses are treated the same, and
exactly.
you want to make sure that you protect your patients.
Exactly.
And the same thing with even the testing of the molds and bacteria. Last year, I ran a bill, and the medical marijuana industry completely got with all their lobbyists, and they got the Democrats to vote no, and it died. So,
interesting.
We'll take.
This is very interesting. And by the way, also, I tell you, we talked 5 years ago about, you know, why just the Indians have this right to do business with the gambling industry. You know, this is kind of, I think it's wrong. You know, we should be able to free to spend our own money, earn money. I don't gamble personally, but if somebody wants to gamble, they're going to gamble no matter what. And why should we lose all these revenues and just for Laughlin or Las Vegas and, of course, these Indian casinos? And I think, you know, we were talking about that a few years ago, and I see that you've been moving very aggressively in a positive way, in my opinion, towards to try to give this opportunity also to regular businesses, you know, like the bingos. You did a lot of great movements there. I'm very proud. I tell you, we had conversation years ago, and I tell you, all these things you've done with the hemp, we were talking about it. And this gambling, the idea, you know, we're supposed to be free to spend our money the way we wish, responsibly, of course, but government shouldn't be our mom. And more important, you know, that's, if we want to get revenues, people should have the chance to do even that way. This is a good business. Now, let's talk about the miner, because I said, you know, I have the miner, Kingman Daily Miner, next to me, one of my buildings. I'm broadcasting here in Kingman from our training facility, Kingman Force on Force, and the miner is my next door neighbor. You know, I try to keep, sometimes, you know, things very professional, but what is true is true. I noticed that, this newspaper, it is not about the news. It's about now political opinions. And when a writer, let's say an editor, starts to completely now mix their opinions in the paper, it doesn't become anymore a newspaper, in my humble opinion. It becomes like an opinion paper. And the sad thing is, you know, that's not what's supposed to be the role of the media. It's supposed to be reporting the facts and people can get their opinions. Now, this piece that I have in front of me is about, let's see exactly, I got the date, was about March the 6th, 2019, and I don't want to read it all, but bottom line, what it says that, you know, they are very, the old miner, at least the board of the miner, came out with this article, and they standing by this thought, and the idea that they want, that they are criticizing your bill, that is SCR-1023, that would change the number of signatures needed from a statewide collection to a district-by-district collection. For a measure that makes a new law to reach the ballot, the signature threshold is 10% of those who voted in the last gubernatorial election. For constitutional measure, it is 15%. Now, before I let you talk, I want to give my two humble sentence here. What I'm really concerned, beside that the miner is becoming like pretty much a political agenda for the Democratic Party, and that's sad, really sad. I believe they should be better than that. But what is really sad about these initiatives that we have, they're becoming very dangerous, that we're supposed to be a constitutional republic. We elect people, maybe good or not. We'll find out at the end of the terms. But that's the way it works. They represent us, and this is not about majority rules. Because when the mob gets together, and that's what's been happening in the last few years, they can pass like almost a parallel legislation. You know, I call it the mob legislation, this referendum, these sort of initiatives, things that normally the legislation wouldn't pass. Now, we know very well that demographics are changing in Arizona. We have people that have been voting fraudulently without the legal status. We've been finding more and more. And the fact is, it takes a moment to reach the 51% of the people out there that can decide that they can take your freedom, your money, and your rights away. And that's not the way this republic is supposed to be, because democracy is a bad word. Democracy means the next step before socialism, before complete violence towards the individual. So I think what you, according to the way I read this bill, to try to limit or try to curb the power of these referendums, that they are very scary. They've been using it for gun control. They've been using it to do things against property rights. Like, you know, if I have a business, I cannot even anymore the right to smoke in my own business because, you know, the majority of people decided so. And so many other terrible things, in my opinion, like, you know, even minimum wage, completely socialistic, terrible coercion agenda. So I'm concerned about this referendum. Even sometimes they may have tried to do something positive, like the, you know, legal marijuana people want to smoke for whatever, that's fine. So tell me what you think about why you somehow supporting this bill that we talk, and what would you like to say to the miner in answer of this sort of editorial?
Well, I find it very interesting.
One second, I lost you. Sonny, are you still there? Sonny? What happened here? Sonny Borrelli, stop. One second, we have a problem here. What happened? I lost you. Okay, no problem. We're going to get him back. We're going to back Senator Sonny Borrelli back. Sonny Borrelli, don't go away. We're going to get you. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with Luca Zanna, and we're going to take 1 second break, and we're going to bring him back. Stay there. Don't go away.
He's a songwriter, a poet, a rifleman.
I'm not afraid.
And a constitutional activist.
I'm not afraid.
Italian by birth.
I'm not afraid.
American by choice. Gianluca Zanna.
I'm not afraid.
And his new CD, Love, Guns, and Freedom. 16 powerful songs on one CD from the heart of a patriot. For download or to order the CD, go to www.loveGunsFreedom.com. That's www.loveGunsFreedom.com. Lyrics for your mind, music for your heart. Gianluca Zanna's new CD, Love, Guns, and Freedom.
Okay. What I find very troubling with that article, or actually, not, it's not even an article, it's not even reporting news, it's all opinion, and it's their opinion, and it's, I find it striking that they're actually siding with the big money donors from other states, the special interest groups, when we're trying to protect Arizona. You know, I don't remember where I left off at before we got disconnected, but, you know, the initiative process is there to, for a reason. But it's, we're sending it back, especially this referendum, we're sending it to the voter to decide if they feel that this is a good program or solution to do something. So they always accuse us of voter suppression when we're sending something to the ballot, which is completely mind-blowing in its own sense. And sometimes I think some people need to put the bong down for about 30 days and then clear their head. But you know, this referendum, it sends it back to the ballot. You summarized it extremely well. Well, the problem is with these citizens initiatives or these special interest group initiatives is they're going to focus in a populated area where it's going to be very easy to gather signatures. For example, Phoenix, Arizona. So while they're trying to gather signatures and put stuff on the ballot, none of us out in rural Arizona have a voice until it's on the ballot.
Exactly.
So what we're trying to do is give balance to, wait a minute, if this is going to affect all of us, I think we should all participate in that process. Every county should be able to participate in that process if they want that on the ballot or not.
You're right.
Because, if, you know, this costs the taxpayers when it goes on the ballot. It costs money to put things on the ballot. They're running an election. And once again, they force things down. You know, there's a lot of unintended consequences. You brought up the minimum wage. You know, the city of Flagstaff did their own minimum wage thing, and guess what? They started unfortunately putting people out of business.
Yeah.
And they actually had to start laying people off because some people that were contracted in the healthcare industry for senior living, they couldn't meet that minimum wage standard, even their minimum wage standard. Forget the state one. They couldn't even meet the minimum wage standards. The next one thing you know, because it was some of this was government funded, they had to come back to the legislature and ask for money to pay these health workers for these elderly homes. But see, and you're right, it's a socialist agenda to try to collapse the system. It's Cloward and Piven, you're right. We're not a democracy. We are a republic. A democracy is two wolves and a sheep voting what they're going to have for lunch.
Exactly. Exactly.
You know, and that's just, that's very problematic on the way that whole thing works. But for example, the last ballot initiative they had for that green energy one that was on the last, during the last election, that came in from, that was put on the ballot by out of state California big billionaire Tom Steyer to put that on the ballot. And that would have completely ran every, if that would have passed and put that mandate on business, guess what? Who would have won? You know, the guy that put this on the ballot, he's the one who would have stood to make billions of dollars off that initiative.
Yeah.
But that would have jacked everybody's electric rates through the roof.
Yeah.
I have a friend of mine in San Diego because they had that solar initiative there and that mandate. And this guy is living in a one bedroom apartment. His electric bill is almost $1,200 a month.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh, bro. How often do you run that air conditioner? 2 weeks in the summer.
Oh my
That's
gosh.
It when the Santa Ana's. In San Diego, you really don't need air conditioning.
Wow.
But that's the kind of stuff that's going on. So what we're trying to do, this initiative, is this referendum puts balance in there. So if you want something on the ballot, you're not going to only talk to the big people in the state of Maricopa. You're going to reach out to the rest of the counties that are out there. You need to get our opinion before you just shove something on the ballot. Because there's a lot of unintended consequences when these things get on the ballot. I spoke earlier about the Marijuana Act, on a lot of problems for that. And now the only way for me to fix it is to send this something else back to the ballot and say, these are things that need to be fixed. And we need your help to fix it so that way the program runs properly. Because it literally became a political, partisan issue. And the Democrats are going to protect their own. And the marijuana industry is, they claim it, that's their own. Well, if you say this is about medicine, let's treat it like a medicine. But they don't care because the industry wants to say, no. We like the Wild West. We like doing what we want to do, and we don't care about the patients. We only care about profits. And there's another thing that's later on when the session ends, and I get back on the show. I'll hopefully some things actually pan out. I'll go on and be able to expand on some of those issues in more detail, which I think your listeners are going to be very astounded when they hear it.
Yeah, I appreciate it. That's very important. At least I really do. And as I said, you know, listeners, this is a show that is not just in the tri-state area or Mojave County. We have listeners all over the world from the internet. And the point is just this one. I wish parts like Italy, other parts around the Europe or the world in general, they had a chance that we have here in Arizona. Even things I said, not perfect, but we still have a chance to make it better. We still have a chance to work with our government. Because after all, what I like about our state government, at least, it's almost like a part-time job. So you're not like the pros that they stay there for. I mean, look in Italy. Italy, you know, I was looking yesterday at the news, even in Congress. I mean, look at Pelosi. I mean, she's been there for 30 years, 40 years, and she got billions of dollars, I mean, millions of dollars. But in Italy, for example, just to give you an idea, a politician does a couple terms, and he comes back home with a retirement of €100,000 for life. I mean, this is insane. You guys, you get peanuts in relationship with many other states' legislators. I was talking with Representative Biasucci last week. You know, the money you get is barely just to pay the basic expenses. So and you still come back and you have a limited terms. That's, I think, is really good. So it's a great opportunity. And if things don't go right, it is also our fault because we don't get enough involved. That's my humble opinion. Go ahead.
Yeah, and you're right on that opinion, or that fact. Yeah, rural Arizona, you know, we all get paid the same. It's $24,000 a year is our salary, and it's mandated by the voter. But for, you know, legislators from rural Arizona, you know, I have to maintain an apartment a year round in Phoenix because I'm in Phoenix two or three times a month when we're out of session. So Everybody just thinks we're a part-time legislature, so it's part-time pay.
Yeah.
Well, if you treat this job like a part-time job, you're really not doing your job. So I'm in Phoenix two or three times a month.
Yeah.
When we're out of session, normally. Well, now I'm the majority whip, so I'm going to be there more so because when we're out of session, there's a lot of issues that go on in the district that need to be addressed. You know, with city government, county government, constituents have issues that I need to do some FaceTime with a lot of the bureaucracy in Phoenix with these state agencies. And it's easy to say no over the phone, but when they have to say no to me in my face, it gets really difficult. But well, it is frustrating because it's funny how the rural legislators always basically, this is just covering our expenses. All the ones that are in Phoenix, they go home every night and,
they got their salary.
They can afford to say no on everything and be an obstructionist. And, but it's kind of ironic, but, that's okay. We knew this going in. This is a labor of love because I love this state. I love this country. I spent my entire adult life serving my country. I was 22 years in the Marine Corps. I was on city council, obviously in the House of Representatives for 4 years. I'm on my second term in the Senate. This is not really a livelihood to me. This is a labor of love because, you know what? Somebody's got to take a stand. And I'm very fortunate and blessed to be in a district where I can be a pain in the neck in Phoenix and be a real, real thorn in people's sides. But in our district, it makes me look like a star. And that's what's great. Because then I can be able to be free to move about the cabin. Yeah. And really, you know, be that agitator that needs to get things done, because I do make waves, and that's what counts.
You're
you
right.
You brought up earlier about the tribal gaming.
Yeah.
Well, that was once again the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act out of Congress authorized tribes to be able to do gaming on their own sovereign property, but then it had to go, you know, so the state had to legalize it. Well, the state legislature didn't take the initiative and put together a compact that would have been beneficial for the state and the tribes, so they didn't do it. They blew it. The act of failure was failing to act, so what happened? It went on the ballot. So guess what? The citizens voted, and we have a compact the way the citizens, you know, voted, but it's the way that one side wrote the compact. So trying to get things done, for example, sports betting. Sports betting, the Supreme Court ruled last May that sports betting you cannot prohibit the tribes from doing it. So now, but you have to change the law in Arizona to allow the tribes to be able to do sports betting. And I've introduced a bill to do just that. But I want to go a little bit more than that. Instead of just doing sports betting inside the casino, I want to take advantage of existing technology. I can go into a casino in Laughlin and I don't have to walk up to the sports desk. I can just go up to a kiosk and place a bet. And then hopefully if I win, I go redeem it. But if I want to take that kiosk up, take it out of the casino, and put it in a bar, you know, a series 6, 7, and 14. A 6 is a series liquor license for a bar only, not a food. 7 is a beer and wine, and a 14 is the VFW, American Legion, Eagles, Elks, private clubs. That club license, so that would restrict it to those certain areas because you got to be 21 to be in a bar, you got to be 21 to gamble. So let's try to do that. Now, that off-site betting, that would be subject to a 6.75% entertainment tax. That's the same tax formula that Nevada gaming does for sports betting. So that's reasonable. It's actually under the regular TPT formula, so it's actually cheaper.
Yeah.
But at least the state would get a piece of it. Obviously, the tribes would get their revenue. But a bar owner, they can negotiate whatever percentages or a rent space with the tribe. So, you know, that's something I'm trying to get done, but I'm running into roadblocks on that because a lot of tribes, you know, there's one big tribe that wants to, who's opposing it because they want to use that as leverage for renegotiating the compact that has to be updated in three years from now. Well, they've been negotiating for 2.5 years, but all the tribes walk away. So, you know, so it becomes that power play. Well, everybody says, Sonny, why are you doing this hard stuff? Well, because the easy stuff everybody else can do.
No, I think you're right, because there's a lot of, listen, when you touch gambling, you're talking about almost, it's the mafia, seriously, the mafia or the potential competition of other former governments that pretty much is a monopoly there too. So what you're doing, I think, is really, really, I tell you, you got guts, because you're talking about people making billions of dollars out of this, and now they have something that we, as a state of Arizona, we want to start to get our piece of the action too, and it's not right that they have just these chosen ones.
That's an excellent point you brought up about organized crime. Prior to the state lottery, you know, all the states before they had the lottery, that was the numbers game was run by organized crime.
Yeah.
So when the states started authorizing the lottery, it put the those wise guys out of business in that racket.
Yeah.
So, once again, you took away the criminal element, and you got legalized gaming that takes the criminal element out of it. That sports betting, if I was running this, if I was in the New York legislature and I was trying to run this bill the way it is,
it would be dead.
Because it really technically gets rid of the illegal bookmaker at the end of the bar,
yeah,
you know, or in the barbershop or wherever he is. You know, you put him out of business. If I was in the New York legislature, I'd probably be dead already.
Exactly. It's true. As I say, what you're doing, it's really, I'm pretty impressed. I really am. And as I said, you know, I want to be sure out there, because today My point is to bring facts. And these are votes. These are real facts. There are no opinions. And of course, if you want to think that you have a different opinion about the role of government, if you think government should tax the hell out of you and pretty much do everything for you at the same way, take all your liberty, probably Sonny Borrelli, Senator Sonny Borrelli is not the right person. And as I said, I want to be sure you understand. We had our differences. If people cannot listen to one of my shows about 3-4 years ago, whatever, you cannot believe it. So I don't want to hear like, oh, you must be now, you know, bothering Senator Borrelli. No, because I give due what is due. I mean, seriously, I'm impressed and I'm glad that I call you, can call you my state senator. Because what you're doing is amazing. Now, the last thing I want to say, you talk bureaucrats. I'm very,
To that point, Luca, you know, a lot of people get misinformed about a lot of issues. And that's okay. You were misinformed. There's a lot of people misinformed. Look at that thing in the miner. They're misinforming everybody with their own political slant to it and spin. Because here they are, they're saying that we're trying to undermine the voters and their voice. I'm putting something on the ballot. But they're technically siding with those out-of-state big money donors of that narrative that's actually in Phoenix. So what they're doing is just regurgitating what Phoenix's point of view is, because that's where the big government is.
Yeah.
And the Democrat Party's take, so they're trying to make that takeover. And here we are, we're trying to like push that back and say, wait a minute, these things are being abused. And for example, somebody could put on the ballot that everybody gets $500 a year rebate from the state government.
Yeah.
If that got voter approved, that would literally bankrupt the state.
Yeah.
Oh. And what would that would cause us? So we'd have to raise taxes and stuff like that. But in order for us to raise taxes, we need 3/4 vote or 2/3 vote or go send it to the ballot. Well, everybody's going to vote no on taxes.
Yeah.
And, you know, then it becomes a political football. Nobody's going to raise your taxes on a vote either in the legislature. So it's a Cloward, Piven, collapse of system, you know, method.
And look at Bloomberg. Look at Bloomberg from New York, what he's doing. He's been financing all these sort of grassroots groups that they do all these state initiatives. Look what happened in Washington State with the gun control in Oregon. I mean, they're in Nevada. They're destroying the state with these initiatives. And this is really the agenda. Whenever they cannot reach their votes with our, you know, regular system, they go through these referendums and they take over like a cancer. I'm telling you, I am very concerned. Because I can see the big picture now, especially when you start to see that people like, you know, these puppets, you know, like Alexandra Cortez can read entire shoes, but she's still been elected, and she has like 60, 70 co-sponsors for something that, like the Green Deal, that is something out of 1994 on steroids in Halloween Day. I mean, that plan that she has, that would be almost like a horror comedy story if it wasn't true. The fact that not just her, she's coming out with that garbage. The fact that we have co-sponsors, 60, 80 people, they completely go for it, and the agenda is complete, total control, a nihilistic society where the government destroys everything. I mean, she wants to kill all the cows, for God's sake, just because they fart. I mean, think how stupid these people are, crazy, but they really believe it. And more important, they want to tax the hell to slavery, us. That's the reality. So we are very close here in Arizona. And
they're not crazy. They know exactly what they're doing. They
you're
have
right.
the agenda. They know exactly what they're doing.
I agree.
You know, and sometimes Luca, everybody thinks, oh, Luca's nuts. He's this conspiracy theory. They're crazy. Not I'm like, no, you've been to other countries and you've seen the impact of socialism and communism. Same thing as I have when I was in the Marines. I was overseas. I see how these countries are run. I see the corruption. And when you have too much power, you know, absolute power corrupts absolutely. And, you know, thank you for letting me come on your show, Luca.
Thank you. Thank you. Please, I appreciate it. Just give the website where people can reach you. Just that. And then you can go, please.
Well, you can contact my office. It's 602-926-5051. Or send me an email. Legislative email is sborrelli, S-B-O-R-R-E-L-L-I. At azleg.gov.
Thank you, Senator Borrelli. I appreciate it, okay? Have a good weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Okay. Hey, we continue now. I tell you, I am very happy that sometimes, you know, I do this show, and sometimes I think, why am I doing this? Seriously. I'm so tired sometimes. I do so much. Maybe I do too much. But the opportunity that I have to talk to people in a way that we can share this talk with the rest of us in a public forum, I think that's really make it worth it. Because the idea, as I said at the beginning, things are not perfect, but it's our job to improve them. If we just stay home watching TV and minding our business, There is an expression, a proverb, you know, good man doing nothing, you know, evil will flourish. Probably I completely destroyed that phrase. But anyway, the point is, the worst thing can happen that good people doing nothing. We got to do our part. What's happening right now in this country, it is really we're in a critical stage. It's like a cancer that's been infiltrating the last 50, 60, 70 years, slowly, slowly, in the fiber of our republic. Now the cancer is proud to spread out. It is not shy anymore. When you have people like Bernie Sanders, you know, completely declaring themselves socialist, they declare their agenda. When you have people like Alexandra Cortez that pretty much says, I'm the boss and I want to control your life, tell you also what you can eat for, don't let me cuss, please, for sake, you know, I mean, seriously. We are really at that point, very, very close to what I may consider a civil war. Sorry. I want to be fair. I'm very mild person. I'm very civil. I hate violence. But if the moment that I see that there is an organized plot to destroy this republic, destroy our lives and our freedom, like me, many other people took an oath to defend this republic. And I will not stand by just taking it. I will not stand by just because you, 51% of the mob, decide that it's okay to take away my gun rights or my property rights or my whatever income that I may have just because you decide so. I'm not going to get away with that. I mean, you're not going to get away with that. You're going to see something that probably in Europe you've never seen. Socialism has been working many parts of the world in a way that, in a destructive way, it's been working. It means it's been infiltrating and taking over. There is an expression that I really truly believe. Socialism will be taken over by votes. But the only way you can somehow get rid of it is going to be by bullets. I'm sorry. It happens. And even in the former, you know, Russia-occupied territories like Eastern Europe, look at Romania, look at Bulgaria. People had to revolt. People had to physically revolt. That's a fact. The good thing about America, even as much as our... you know, socialized public re-education camps, like I call them, you know, the public school, they already pretty much brainwash a good part of the population. As much as, you know, all this media, most of the media is a conglomerate controlled by the same five, six families that they all pretty much follow the same agenda. But they want socialism. Remember, the big guys, the big corporations love socialism because socialism destroys the competition, destroys free market. That's what they want. Okay, so they're all for socialism. So remember, regardless of all the situation, that we are pretty much in a bad shape, we are still are in America, where many of us, as, first of all, never forgotten who we were, and the DNA is still there. Even if you are not born here, when you come to America, I really truly believe if you come with the idea to become part of this heritage, you are part of also this DNA. And I tell you, I don't need to remind you what happened in 1775, okay, in April, when they tried to take the guns of the American people. I don't need to remind you what can happen again. So the debate is going to be pretty much settled in a different way here. And that's it. Let's leave it like that. All right, listen, at this point, I want to take a little break. They will continue. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna. I really appreciate your support. This is not financed by any special interest. I don't even go around looking for sponsors because I want to completely keep the show free. That means we can talk about everything you want. Just we keep the language civil, and that would be the idea. Now, I want to be sure one thing. We mentioned the Kingman Daily Miner. I will call the Kingman Daily Miner editor, that, by the way, you know, I know him pretty well, Mr. Sean. I call him, and I would love him to have him on the air if he wants to come, or anybody from the newspaper. Because at that point, you know, that's the way I do it. Even this is an opinion radio show. It is not a news radio show. I like to have a chance to always to get both sides of the story. And more important, regardless, I like to let them talk. You know, this is not about me being right. It's about giving the chance for people to share what they think without censorship. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom. Do not go away.
Are you ready to get lost in lust? Immerse yourself in a thunderstorm of emotions and passion. Order John Luca Zanna's new book, Perfectly Crazy, 69 Erotic Visions and Love Poems, with forbidden erotic Italian phrases. Perfectly Crazy, by John Luca Zanna. Available all over the world at Amazon.com and www.zanna.us.
Here we are back into the studio. You're listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna on K-Talks 1340 AM and also 104.1 FM. That was a really good interview with Senator Sonny Borrelli. As I said, we had our own differences in the past. I had also, you know, just to be sure that people out there, they think that maybe, oh, you are a Sonny Borrelli Republican fan club. No, I have no fan club. As I said before during the interview, in the past I was critical about Sonny Borrelli. At the time I was a representative, Sonny Borrelli. And I tell you, I was wrong on many issues. I think his voting records is proving me that at least, you know, you may like him or not as a person. He may be a colorful person. Honestly, I like him as a person. I think he's a funny guy. You know, sometimes a little rough. But guess what? You know what? We are not millennial here, okay? We are not this snowflake, white flake, or whatever. I have no problems to have somebody a little argument or whatever, debate, or even just, you know, between friends, slap on the face and then shake hands, okay? The guy is cool. I like him. He is a grown-up guy, I'm telling you. You remember my last show about him? You know, the first show we had him was on my, you know, as when he was a just elected fresh representative. It was one of my first interviews, and I really thank him just for the time to come on my show. But then, you know, we had our differences, different things, especially the last election when he ran for senator. And guess what? I like the fact that he doesn't serve and keep any type of grudge, and he moves forward. And as I said, I'm the first one to say sorry about it, and we move on. So I really enjoy his presence as a person for fun. Even, you know, people may say, he called you, if you didn't vote for him, he called you that sucker. Guess what? We are grown up. We can move forward. I have no problem with that, okay? Sometimes I call people names too, and that's okay. You know, as I said, we all are grown up people, and I think we can have a little bit of a thick skin, right? So anyway, that's said enough. Now, let's talk about serious stuff. It's all serious, don't get me wrong. Let's talk about things that are happening, okay? First of all, little bit of a note. If you live in Mojave County, Arizona, it's going to happen a very special event in just a couple of weeks. A Kingman First on Force here in Kingman, Arizona, where also I'm broadcasting from, located 3001 Stockton Hill Road, Unit Number 1. We're going to have a very unique event, a special Krav Maga self-defense workshop. Saturday and Sunday, the 30th and the 31st of March, we have a special instructor coming directly from New Jersey, who also is a level 7 Krav Maga instructor, Greg, and I had him on my show a couple of weeks ago. It's going to be an incredible opportunity for Mojave County. I mean, this is not just some Krav Maga instructor, okay? This is the Krav Maga instructor, level 7, directly from the Krav Maga American Federation, normally trains in Israel. It is amazing. It's going to be a very good class. I think hopefully you can get the opportunity. We have only three seats left. The class is going to be limited. I don't want to have 100 people. It's going to be just 10 students and two potential, you know, instructors, students. That's it. It's going to be a very small class, but it's going to be very intense. What is Krav Maga, in case you don't know it? It is the self-defense system. It was created by the Israeli for the special forces, for the soldiers in general, and also adopted around the world by law enforcement and different military, you know, from around the world. It's very instinctive. It is very based on practical use of your body in an instinctive way to defend against any violent threat, okay, armed and unarmed. So it's a very great opportunity. I'm proud that I was able to somehow meet Greg, that, by the way, will fly directly from New Jersey for this special event. So, again, March the 30th and the 31st, special Krav Maga self-defense workshop at Kingman Force on Force here. Limited seats. If you're interested, go to kingmanforceonforce.com. I appreciate it to see you here. I'll be here anyway. Now, let's go back to us. I am concerned. I really am. And this is probably the only reason why I'm on the air. I don't have any other reasons. For personal entertainment, I couldn't care less. My ego is fulfilled enough with my things I do in my life. Don't get me wrong. I like to talk to you guys. I think even I never really have a double chance to conversate. But, you know, it is an incredible opportunity to reach out to people that I never met in my life and maybe I'll never meet. But still, you know, I feel humble when you listen to me. I don't even know why, but I appreciate it, okay? So anyway, my point is, I'm here because I know in general right now, as humanity, we are facing something that it's happening right now. This has been emotional for many, many years. The takeover of the world by the globalists to create this global tyranny, it is not something happened yesterday. It's been a long-term plan. But I really believe right now in this generation, what's happening is something that is crucial. It's the next step. The next step before really they're going to unleash hell, if you believe in hell, on earth. That's the point. And they will not come all dressed up like little devils, you know, with a little pitchfork and things like that. No, they will come facing you like people like, you know, Alexandra Cortez, okay, or Bernie Sanders, or Hillary Clinton. And don't get me wrong, there are a lot of Republicans there into this too, okay? I want to be sure you understand, I'm not a party guy. Okay, I burned my Republican card a long time ago, and I'm very, very disgusted by some Republicans. But for sure, there is no Democrats out there that I like. This is no more the Democratic Party of JFK, okay? This is now, it's a socialist/communist party with the goal and the goal and the purpose to destroy America from within. Now, what I'm really concerned here, it is very simple. What we have here already, it's a global government in the middle of action, I mean, actuating, implementing their plan. But now, for more specifically, America, this United States of America, the country that I chose to be, I feel like this is the last stage we have before we're going to face the same threat that the world is already facing. Look at Canada, what happened the last year or two, under, you know, Prime Minister Trudeau. This complete surrendering of their national sovereignty, the complete enslavement under the United Nations, the complete, you know, bondage under eternal debt created by, really, a madman that is not mad, but he knows exactly what he's doing, giving billions away to around the world. And of course, you know, all this implementing the all parts of Agenda 21, like no property rights, the carbon tax, and cannot even use anymore your resources. And of course, they want you completely unarmed. So gun confiscation and gun registration, but with the total control of any firearms in the hands of civilians, is being actuated around the world. Now, in America, we are one step away. I still don't understand, really, what's going to happen here with Trump, President Trump, because, honestly, I see that there is a moment that I start to see that he seems to slow down this trend. At the same time, I still see that he's doing things that make no sense. I know he's just a man. I know, after all, he's surrounded by there is a stealth government. But my point is, if he cannot do something himself, that he still has a couple hours of office, who's going to do what's supposed to be done when we have the next president? That's the question. When you think you have at that point, you know, a Congress, a Democratic Congress, and a president is a Democratic president, or maybe just another Bush out there that follows, is part of the agenda of the New World Order. You think, who's going to somehow save our sovereignty? Who's going to save our borders? Who's going to stop somehow these crimes, these criminals in our government? When even Trump cannot do it. But think about it. I'm still in shock the fact that we are now more than 2 years into this presidential, you know, election, and President Trump, with all the powers they're supposed to have as executive chief, cannot even have an attorney general that can bring justice back to America. That's really saddening me, because it made me realize that we are living in illusion. This is no more the land of the free, home of the brave. This is now the land of the Clintons, the land of the Bushes. This is the land of the New World Order, the land of double standard. You know, where people can rot in jail just for a couple of photos taken innocently in a submarine. You know, like I had, you know, one of my guests here, Navy sailor, I forgot his last name. Anyway, spent, you know, years and get a felony just to take a little photo innocent of himself in the submarine. Years later, they prosecuted him and threw the book at him. And then we have Hillary Clinton breaking every federal law that you can imagine, lying to Congress, destroying evidence, and everything else you can think. And guess what? She's running for president. I mean, this is amazing. But the sad thing is, I really truly believe evil is showing itself now through faces of, in this reality, of politicians, of laws, of things that they're going to make you believe they are. Somehow, just because government is sanctioning them, they are okay. I mean, listen to this. Just 1 second. This is disgusting, beyond disgusting, okay? I think you need to listen.
Action on, they'll start to bring the baby down a little bit more. And then if they're bringing the baby down more, the arms start to come into view. And they'll reach up with one finger, they'll grab the right arm, they'll sweep it down, and they'll deliver the right arm. Then they'll rotate the baby around, and they'll deliver the left arm. Now at this point, 90% of the baby is on the outside. You know, the baby has already completely left the womb and is beyond the cervix, and it's just the baby's head that's sitting there still in the vagina. Legally, the baby is not born yet. Alright, the baby hasn't taken its first breath. The baby's alive, moving, doing its thing while it's being held in the doctor's hand. And I use the term doctor really loosely. But the baby's being held right there. But what they need to do now is they need to, you know, do the abortion procedure. They need to kill the baby. And the way they do that, it's one of the more common ways, is they'll use a pair of scissors like this. Now, you remember from your biology class, remember the foramen magnum, that hole in the base of the skull where your spinal cord comes down from the brain into the back into the spine? This scissor is then placed at the base of the baby's neck, at the base of the skull, and is forced up into the baby's
Hey, this is for all the Democrats who are believing in late-term abortion. You may rot in hell. I despise you. Seriously, you are murderers. You've been listening to Love, Guns, and Freedom with luca-zanna, and God's willing, may the gods bring you peace and win over your enemy. Victory over your enemy. I'll talk to you next time. Ciao.
To kill your faith. Every day you're invaded, your soil desecrated, politicians turn their back, you're under attack, you're under attack. They're trying to erase your borders, the UN wants to give you orders, they're trying to sell your pride.